Hey guys, happy Wednesday all. Thanks so much for coming in tonight. I appreciate it. And thank you replay viewers for being here. And thank you YouTube viewers for being here. YouTube viewers, if you would like to watch live on Periscope, join me every night at 9:30 p.m. Central. And you can find me on Periscope at penguinandfish. Thanks so much. We are going to continue on the embroidery of block 31 of the Splendid Sampler tonight. We got a little farther than I thought we would last night, so I'm pretty excited about that. We'll see. I think we'll get this little guy up here done tonight. I'm going to flip you guys around, and we will get going. Hello, hello, guys. Happy Wednesday. Man, I almost didn't make it here tonight. I have, if you guys have been here for the past few days, you know that I've been visiting my parents, and I just got home last night, and so I was just catching up on Facebook messages and all that. Just now when I looked at my clock, and it was 9:23, and I can barely set up in the 7 minutes or something that I had left, so whew, just made it. But man, that got my heart pumping for a second there. So all right, we are going to continue on block 31 of the Splendid Sampler, called Blossoming, by Jennifer Reynolds. And we got a little farther than I thought we would last night. I thought this bird would take a couple more days than just the one day we got it done in. So, woohoo, we got the bird, and we got this little string going up here, and I think we will try and finish this spool quick and try and finish this birdie tonight, and maybe we'll get lucky and start the rest of it. This will be all we get done until I make it up some other day, because tomorrow is new block day for the Splendid Sampler. The Splendid Sampler, it's the year-long quilt-along that we've been working on. It's a mystery quilt-along, so we get new blocks every Thursday and Sunday, and tomorrow's Thursday already, which is crazy. It was a short week this week, so new block tomorrow, so we'll get as far as we can today, and then we will switch over. This will go into the unfinished projects folder, side of my binder. I have my binder of all my blocks, and one side are all the finished, and the other side are my unfinished ones that we've been trying to make up here as we go, when we can fit it in. So this will go in that pile, which is okay. We'll get it done eventually. If you guys are new here, my name is Alyssa Thomas from Penguin and Fish, where we create lovely and quirky hand embroidery patterns and kits. I'm the author of Sew and Stitch Embroidery and a fabric designer as well. And we have the cutest embroidery kits of little animals on the interweb, so you can go check them out at penguinandfish.com. Oh, we're in the 50s. All right, I am going to flip you guys around. Let me know what you're working on tonight and if you've got this block done or if you're working on this flame sampler at all. And let me know how your day went today. All right, guys. Here we are tonight. Okay, so I have some thread left over. Ooh, you guys, I'm going to turn you a little bit. I can't read your comments here. Okay, there we go. I think that'll help me a little bit. Just angling it up a little bit more. I couldn't see the screen. So, all right, I have a little bit of thread left from last night. We started with 6-strand embroidery floss, and I'm only using 2 strands to stitch this because it's a pretty delicate design with lines really close to each other. So I switched my usual, which is 3 strands of thread, and I switched to 2 strands from 6-strand embroidery floss. So I've already used 4 of these strands on this pull, and I'm on my last one here. So, all right, let's get going with that. Oh, I missed what you guys were saying. Oh, are you using a thimble for yours? You know, I'm kind of into the thimble now for applique. So that's been kind of fun. I wanted to try and figure out how to use a thimble a little bit better. And so for some of those appliques, I was using the thimble. It's catchy, that thimble. So I'm just weaving in the end to get started so I don't have any knots in the back. I read that the thimble is going to keep the... Oh, it's to keep the first knuckle from bending. Oh, that's interesting. I wonder if I have a... I got my thimble here. I got to check that. Okay. Here's my thimble. Mine doesn't. Mine still bends on this, but the leather one probably doesn't. I wonder where that would be. I gotta, now that I'm trying to use the thimble and some other things, now I gotta do my research into it and see like the reasoning behind everything. Oh, it helps the hand not fatigue. Well, that's interesting. Oh, you become a thread weaver. How do you like it? I solely do it. I got myself a knot already. Jeez Louise. Not paying attention and got myself a loopy knot. I like it purely for the reason that you can... Oh, no hoop! Yeah, you guys are right. Man, see, I'm totally out of it. All right, I gotta get this guy into the hoop. You are right. I took it out of the hoop and gotta go. I use leather on my thumb. It's comfortable with metal on the middle. Oh, interesting. Oh yeah, because you do the double thing for your quilting. So the push and then the pull with it. It's that car drive. I'm telling you, I get messed up from those long drives. It's not even that horribly long. It's a 5-hour drive, but I get like, it takes me a couple days to get back into things. You know, and then I'm playing catch up with work stuff, and yeah, totally, it's totally car leg. That's funny. That's going to be my excuse from now on. I got car leg. But yeah, I thought I usually set an alarm to at like 9:10, and that's my, hey, your scope is coming up. You should probably set up if you have something difficult to set up or whatever. And then I have another, it's not a time change, yeah. And then I have another alarm that goes off at 9:20. That's my, like, final alarm. Like, oh, you gotta, you know, set up the computer and the recorder and the lights and all this other stuff. So that's my, like, my point of no return alarm. And I forgot to set both of them today. And I don't automatically have the alarms on because I don't know. I'm paranoid that I'll be going to a movie somewhere and then it'll go off in the middle of the movie. So around like 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock when I remember like, oh, I got my scope tonight. What am I doing? Then I'll set my alarms. And I must have forgot to do that tonight. So, arg. But I made it just in time here. All right. I'm going to sew. You know what? I think I'm going to go around the outside. Oh, here. Let me get you guys in focus first. There we go. I think I'm going to go along the outside of this spool first, because then when I do the threading, the thread little bits here, the thread will go over the top of the spool, which is, you know, actually what's happening in real life. So sometimes when I'm embroidering, I like to think about that. What's the thing that's furthest back in space, and do that part first, and then do the things that are forward in space next. Like with this bird, for example, too, I'll probably do all this bottom bird stuff and then do the heart after it, because the heart kind of lays on top of the bird. Yeah, in real life, the thread would be wrapped on top of this spool. All right. Oh, and I'm upside down now because I kind of just rotate my hoop the way that it's easiest for me to hold and do the next stitch. So I'm always kind of constantly turning it. Like that thing that was my huge aha moment in kindergarten when my teacher said, turn your paper, not the scissors, when you're cutting. That's stuck with me ever since, and it's the same thing with this embroidery, for me at least. My embroidery doesn't have smooth lines like yours. How can you improve? Around the curves? For me, the smooth lines kind of come... I reduce the size of my stitch around the curves, and then I, you know, I'm okay with them being a little longer on the straightaways, but around the curves, I'm doing, like, even, like, if you look up at this guy way close, it's a ton of little stitches because it's such a tight curve. So the more stitches, the more accurate I can be on the curves. And with the back back stitch here, I'm really trying to make sure that I get, you know, when I'm doing this stitch back to the next stitch, I'm really working hard to try and get it in that exact same hole that I came out of before. Looks like a kid with scissors. Yeah, because this is such a detailed embroidery as far as the small little shapes and arcs and turns that are happening. Like, even right here. Oh, yours is jagged. I think maybe just focus on really getting your stitch when you go back, if you're doing a back stitch, when you go back to your previous stitch to really get it in the same hole. Oh, yeah, yeah. For back stitch, you want to go into the same hole. So you're coming out, you know, you're coming out a stitch away. And you want to go back in that exact same hole that your last stitch finished on. And that's what's going to connect the lines all good. If you're doing like a different stitch, like a stem stitch, a stem stitch can be jaggedy. Oh, yeah, any sneak peeks? I have not checked yet. But yeah, I mean, look at, this has got a lot of little details, this embroidery. Like this guy here kind of bumped up a little here before it curved in. And it's got this slight arc here. And all those little angles and curves you can get if you do a little smaller stitches. You haven't seen any? Yeah, they had that bonus block yesterday, so I'm thinking they won't re-release it today, but you never know. I suppose it's kind of late already, so I'm guessing it won't come out till it's supposed to, which is tomorrow. So we'll see. Well, maybe we'll be back to sewing. That'd be my guess, at least. Since we've been stitching this whole time, which is embroidering for the past few days, which was perfect because I was, you know, out of town at my parents' house, and man, embroidery is so much easier to do when you're out of your, you know, own personal sewing space. Sewing a quilt, we just keep embroidering, yeah. This spool is awfully cute. Everything gets cuter once you start embroidering it, that's for sure. Cute. What's so funny is I bet you if I would have skipped I hope some of you might have done this if you saw me on Facebook, like commenting on Facebook, and it was time for my Periscope, then you guys could be like, oh, why weren't you in your Periscope? Then that would have woken me up. So I have faith that you guys, someone here would have called me out. And then I would have gotten back to it. Oh, man. I mean, I seriously had minutes to spare. I just, like, barely anything. And I kind of have a lot of setup with the computer and the tripod and all that sort of stuff. So I ran out here and got it all prepped. Oh, and I was able to get them uploaded, all my videos that I wasn't able to upload when I was at my parents' house for this block. And so they're uploaded, I just need to do all the graphics and the text for it. So I will do that tonight, probably, before I head to bed. And so they'll probably be up for reals tonight. Not this one, because this one will take a while to upload, but all the other ones will be. Gotta make me some title graphics and a description for ya. Alright. So see, this is another case where the two embroidery floss threads instead of the three are allowing us to do like these delicate lines that are really close to each other. Because any thicker, I mean, this is already becoming kind of like a mass of threads, which is fine for the spool like this, because it gets a little further apart here, so it's going to give us the effect of that thread. But any more threads, like if I did my three strands, which I usually do, I think we'd kind of have a massive line here. It'd be difficult to see the lines. That is my thought, at least. Oh, you know, I could have done one long stitch. I didn't think about that. I don't know. I guess I was just keeping with, that would have been cute, just to do one long stitch. I was just keeping with my, the thread length that I was kind of doing for the rest of the straightaways, and didn't think about doing one all the way across, but that would have been cute. Oh, well. These would be little pinky toe holds if I did it all the way across, maybe. What do we call those? Toe holes, right? Or toe grabbers or something. I've been using three on bigger areas and two in the delicate areas. Oh, I bet you that looks lovely. There's something just really neat about toe hooks. There you go. These are little pinky toe hooks, maybe, if I did it all the way across. I love that phrase, toe hooks. I think that's a cool idea to do thick on some parts and thin. It really adds a fun texture to do different numbers of strands. I'm going to do it all one color of thread. I mean, it's completely a personal preference. Oh, can't speak tonight. I think it would be really beautiful all in color as well, all different colors. Toe catchers! Oh, there, that sounds good too. Toe hooks and toe catchers. Oh, this is what you're considering. Oh, that was what you were considering, all the different colors. Oh, white and black. Oh, that would be beautiful. Ooh, white on black. That would be stunning, really. That'd be really, really, really beautiful. Yeah, you know, there's just something about, you know, red work or white work, black work, all that stuff, all that one color stuff that really feels traditional and just happy. I don't know. It just feels relaxing and stuff while you stitch it, I think. And it takes more of the decision making out of the process. Oh, you found lots of colors. So, I mean, oh, you saw black with neon DMC thread. Oh, that's kind of cool. But yeah, I don't know. I kind of needed a relaxing, just kind of a more, less thinking embroidery, I guess, since I was working on that nature's block and choosing colors and all that sort of stuff. Oh, thanks. I appreciate that. Yeah, I'm really loving this traditional red work thing. And, you know, I won't do this for all my blocks. If we get another embroidery one, I'll decide to do a bunch of different colors. And, you know, one embroidery, the nature's block, I did all different colors. And then my block 11, I did a bunch of different colors. And then for the snug as a bug, I did just all blue, basically red, like this one, but all like a light blue. Oh, thanks. Yeah, you know, sometimes you want to, you know, sometimes embroidery is great because you can challenge yourself and do lots of different colors and lots of different weights of stitches and lots of different stitches, but sometimes you just want to chill out and just stitch without thinking, and that's kind of what this is to me. And actually, this design looks, to me at least, it looks pretty traditional and cute and rustic, and I like that, and I think the red work kind of goes with that idea a little bit. Yeah, I am using Fabrisalvi here. That's this whole entire thing here. So it sticks right on. You know, I can pull it off still. My needle... So, did you comment about that today? I saw a comment about that today. That only happens... Oh, you did. Okay, so that's only happened to me maybe two or three times. And I think it might have to do with humidity at the time. I'm not positive, but it's only happened to me a couple times. So when it does, I just kind of keep a little damp rig by me, just barely damp, and I just wipe it off every once in a while. But it doesn't happen to me every single time. And the only thing I can, you know, when I, next time that happens, I'll try and pinpoint, okay, what is it about right now that's making that happen? It really has only happened a couple times for me, and my guess is it was because I was stitching with some high humidity or something like that. But yeah, when it does happen, I'm just trying to wipe it off. I know it's probably pretty annoying. Oh. You know, that actually, you know, might be a thing. I'll think about that next time it happens too. You know, it's funny to say and everything, but, you know, that could probably affect it. Like if you're really warm or, you know, stitching underneath a blanket or something like that, maybe that would affect it. I'm not positive. But I will try and sleuth it out, and when it happens again, I will be sure to think about what's going on here. All right, I'm gonna do my little French knot here. So I think I'm gonna do some more videos. Like I love to get personal humidity. Yeah, there you go. I want to do some stitch videos, some really short and sweet stitch videos coming up, and I think French knot, I think that might be my first one that I do. So I for the Twitch videos that are coming up soon, hopefully, I bought a camera finally today, so that will be coming in a couple days, and then once I have that, then I think we can really give this Twitch thing a try, and with that camera, I'll be able to probably shoot these little videos a little bit better. So you guys might be able to see that I'm kind of doing this running stitch in a little odd way. Like normally I would come up and I'd go down and then back up at the next stitch and then down and then up and down, just like in a row, like weave back and forth. But some of them I haven't been doing that, and it's because these are so close together that I'm afraid that if I go right up next to it like this, that there just won't be enough threads kind of holding my stitch. I just get a little nervous. So I've been coming up on the opposite side and then going back, kind of like a back stitch, in a few places where I don't feel like I'd be able to get it up in the right spot. Like for this one example, there's only maybe two little threads in between this stitch and this stitch, so I don't think it'd be sturdy enough for me to just come up right there, right away. So, I don't know, if you're wondering why I was doing that in kind of a weird way, that's why. These are so small, these little itty-bitty stitches. Alright, my brain wants me to do this heart for, or this flower first, just because it's in this body area. But I think since my thread ended right here, I think I'm going to just start the outside of this heart. And I'll probably go and loop up and do this right away and then continue here. And then when I get here, I'll probably do the flower if I have enough thread yet. Just because then I'll be using fabric, or I'll using less thread because I'll not be making all these jumps. You bought what I thought was fabric salvie, but when I got home, I realized it was the paper salvie that tears. Yeah, so that is the thing. That'll still work. It just is a pain in the butt to do all the, to tear it all off, especially with something this detailed. So that's actually what I used to use before I discovered the fabric salvie, and man, the fabric salvie is much better. That's the tricky part about ordering or buying this stuff, is that in that aisle, in the aisle of all these embroidery stabilizers, there's just so freaking much. There's just so many different products, and it's just so difficult. So you just really have to think about, are we flipped still, guys? Here, I'll go up and come back down quick. There's my little candle. I didn't light it today either. Okay, here we are. So you really have to look at two things: how it goes on and how it comes off. Well, and then yeah, so that's basically the two things. So for this, for example, it goes on sticky like a sticker, comes off with water. So you might have gotten goes on like a sticker, tears off, and you know there's go on with heat, and then like with iron on and tear off, you know, and then there's like iron-on and, you know, cutaway, which is basically permanent. So you have to, it's really looking at those, the how it goes on and how it comes off. So, this is supposed to be water soluble though, I hope. So I hope it, oh, the stuff that you got. Well, then it should be good. I mean, if it's a tear away stuff, then you'll probably have to tear it away. But, if it says water soluble, then it should be good. I also got the paper, so I used it for paper piecing. The only problem is the paper. Oh, the paper scorched easily. Do they have a paper specifically for paper piecing? I guess I never looked into that. I'm what I think is DMC floss. I think I've had it since I was like 14 or something, making friendship bracelets. You know, so I have this thing, and it says 75 on there, so I don't know if that means anything. It is a variegated floss, from what I believe is DMC. It's like a red to a maroon, kind of, or a brick red, kind of really close to colors to each other, so it's not much of a variegation, but it's still a little bit there, and it's what I think is DMC floss. But again, I think I've had it since making friendship bracelets a million years ago. That'd be kind of fun to do. Was paper, sulky paper salvy. Sulky paper salvy. Okay, so that probably just doesn't stick on. It's probably, you probably have to sew it on or something, maybe? Yeah, I mean, the fabric salvy is the blue and the black kind. Don't know what to do with it. Does it say how it goes on and how it comes off? It sounds like it just doesn't stick on, which is, you know, awesome. But it sounds like it'll wash away still, if you can figure out how to get it on. You can baste it on, probably. Just give it a test before doing a big embroidery like this. There's a question of, do I think this is the most difficult embroidery so far? Honestly, I think my embroidery is probably the most difficult one so far, just because it's full of all those chain stitches, and the chain stitch can be a little bit of a bear to get used to, but once you get going, it's fine. But yeah, so I guess I would say that mine is probably the most difficult. This is, I mean, not necessarily difficult, but it's very detailed. So it has a lot of little curves, a lot of tiny details, and in theory that can maybe cause some trouble along the way. I have needle sizes 1 through 5, but don't know which is big and which is small. Oh man, I think 5 is the bigger one, but I would have to look that up again. That's one of those late night questions that my brain doesn't do well with. I think it goes bigger with the, I think it goes bigger with the smaller numbers. That's the opposite of what I just said, wasn't it? I think it goes bigger with the smaller numbers. I'm not positive though. Hand needles go smaller. Okay, I'm gonna have to look it up. That's a good question. I should do a whole thing on needles maybe sometime, because first of all, it would help me to research them all again, so I can answer those questions quickly. But yeah, it can get confusing. Sewing needles go bigger. Okay. Yeah, there's a lot to know. I don't worry about that so much. I just worry about the two things again. I worry about, is the eye of the needle big enough to hold my thread? And is it a sharp or blunted point? That's all I really care about. And then you don't want a flexible needle. Like some beading needles are really flexible. That's not what we're looking for. We're looking for something that doesn't flex, which is most needles. And then a large enough eye and a sharp point. We're going for a sharp point with embroidery, not a blunted point, which is what a cross-stitch needle looks like. So a lot of people want to use their cross-stitch needles, but it's not the same. They're blunted, so you don't pierce all your little X's and stuff on your cross-stitch fabric. Whereas with embroidery, you need to actually pierce through the fabric. So you want the sharp point. So yeah, so sizes and all that, you know, I don't always pay so close, probably not as close attention to as I should. I just go for sharp point, large eye, you know, kind of like with the embroidery stabilizers, how it goes on, how it comes off, you know what I mean? That's kind of my focus. All right, we're almost done with this little piece of thread. Then I'll have to start a new piece. This was the last of my last 6-strand pull, so I need to, you know, I can get three basically sessions out of the 1 6-strand because I'm doing 2 strands, so I get to do three times. With the 2 strands, so I'll be doing a whole new one. So I wonder if, you know, this last one was kind of this darker color, slightly darker than the first time, the first pull, which was about this handmade thing. This was a brighter red, and then it got darker on the next pull because it's variegated floss. So I wonder, we'll probably get brighter again all of a sudden, which is kind of funny. All right, I think I'm gonna do one more stitch, and then we will weave this guy in. So I weave in the ends. I'm pretty close to the hoop here. I mean, normally I like using a larger hoop, but I'm trying to save, I'm just trying to save my fabric. You know, I didn't want to cut really big all around here, which is what I do with my normal ones when I'm just using muslin. I just cut bigger pieces and use a bigger hoop so I don't get so close to the hoop here. But I'm just doing with this. You can cut in the color you want to match. Yeah, I could do that. I could continue, make sure that I continue where I left off with the same variegation part, but I'm not worrying about it. I kind of like that it changes abruptly. I think it's kind of interesting. All right, so I'm going to just grab another. I grab about maybe 2.5 feet worth. I know that's kind of a lot for some people, and depending on your thread, like some other threads kind of fray from the friction of going through the fabric over and over again, but I don't know, this DMC floss seems to do just fine, and I like not having to switch as much. Alright, but that's just personal preference. So I'm gonna just do that thing where I take 1 strand of floss out of here at a time to get my 2 strands. I think that's the easiest way to get strands out. When I'm doing 3 strands, I like to just split it in half really slowly, but it gets a little cumbersome when you just need a not centered amount of strands, basically. Not equal amount of strands. So, alright, I've separated the 1, and I'm holding it in my fingers here, and I'm just gonna pull it right out. The rest of it bunches there, but then it all releases perfectly. Alright, I'm gonna grab 1 more. Alright, there we go. Our 2 strands. I'm gonna set the rest of the 4 strands aside for later. Okay, so let's put our, oops, I got a little fabric in there. I'm just going to put our 2 strands back together now. There we are. Actually, I'm not even sure if I started the variegation in the same, I might have turned one the other opposite direction, so we might have a combo. Oh, no, it looks like I did them in the same direction. This is both looking kind of redder up here. Oh, maybe not. I don't know. I'm not sure if I might have flipped the 2 strands end to end. Yeah, that's what I think I actually did. I think I flipped the 2, so the end was to the front and stuff. Oh, DMC 75, variegated cranberry. Okay, mystery solved. There we are. This is some DMC number 75, variegated cranberry. Great sleuthing. I'm working on applique right now. Oh, I love the chain stitch. It's relaxing. Oh, that's good. Yeah, it's definitely relaxing once you get into it, for sure. I like doing it. And, you know, it was kind of maybe a difficult stitch to throw into here, but I do like I mean, the whole point was the concept behind it. Like, the concept behind it was supposed to look like crocheted, like a crocheted doily. So the crocheting is really similar to the chain stitch. But, you know, it looks really lovely in a backstitch, too. I know a lot of people are just doing it in a backstitch, and I think that's actually almost more pretty in ways. I mean, you can finish it faster and stuff, but, you know, again, I like the chain stitch. Hey, Andrew, how are you doing? All right, I think, let's see, where should I start? You know, I think I might start at the flower now and then work my way back around. So I'm going to weave in right here. Yeah, what have you been up to lately, Andrew? Around here, and one more. So I've definitely fallen in line to do this weaving in at the beginning instead of the away knot every single time. This definitely is working better. I do the away knot still for my first starter. But then I try and just weave it into the ends, like what we've been doing here. So that was a nice suggestion. All right. So this, again, is one of these teeny flowers, like what we did here, where we had just the itty-bitty stitches. We're going to do another one of those. So that'll take a little bit of time here, working this little flower. But I think we'll still be able to finish this birdie tonight. There's a guy in Little Grove that scopes feeding raccoons every night? Oh my gosh. I'll have to look that up. They're scary. They were in our neighborhood last year. I know that we were walking around every once in a while. We'd see them. They're big, too. And man, I don't know. I think I would listen to this NPR. You know, it's probably This American Life or something like that. I remember listening to one of those when I was little. I don't know. Have you guys heard this one? It was talking about rabies or something like that, and it was about this person who had this raccoon chase after them because it was rabid, and I don't know, when it's rabid, when things are rabid, they, like, just go at you or something, I don't know, some scary zombie-like action, and I always remember that, so raccoons kind of freak me out in real life. They're cute in, like, pictures and stuff, and I like drawing them and stuff, but when I see him in my neighborhood, I kind of freak out. He's been doing it for years. Oh, yes, they can carry rabies. Yeah, I just remember that thing where, like, that story where she was, like, facing it down and it started tearing after him. I have a friend who has been letting her 8-year-old feed the squirrel, man. All rodents freak you out in real life. Ha ha, funny. He has a pool for them. Sheesh. Oh, a healthy raccoon will chase you for cookies and grapes. See, that's the thing. When I see you and I just walk the other way. I don't know. They're cute. I could have one as a pet if it was like a real animal. Like pet, but man. You raised 4? They're so sweet. Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I mean, if it was domesticated, I could totally wanting one. But I don't know. When I see them out in the wild and they're always staring at you, you know, then it freaks me out. Oh, if they're out in the day, then that's bad news. Okay, that's good to know. I don't know. I have a tiny phobia about them. You know, the more I talk to you guys, the more I'm realizing that I'm afraid of a lot of things, like from when I was little and stuff. There was something last night too that I was like, freaked me out. Oh, what was it? Some sound. Oh, cicadas. Crack one, used to make a bunch of noise. Oh, in the trash. Yeah, we had one in our trash last year. Oh, you learned to hate raccoons. Oh, no. Yes, spiders and other bugs. Yeah, I don't know. Once they get over the 6 legs. If they have 6 legs and they aren't huge, then I don't care so much. But I don't know, past that 6-leg mark, I don't know, something comes over me, they freak me out. Oh, they're like cats. Oh, see, I wanted had a domesticated one, then that would be kind of cool. I know you didn't say the word. Ah, yeah, the millipedes. Ah, I can't even say it. Two racine fighting. It's just primal. Oh, jeez. Oh, yeah, froggies are nice. Dips his cookies in the water, that's funny. Yeah, if they were actually pets, I could see that as being fun. But, yeah, I don't know. And the wild ones freaked me out. And the lady had to have her arm amputated by bitten. See, that's what I'm saying! The raccoons, they chase you or something. You know what? I used to be afraid of sea urchins, too. Actually, I'm a little afraid of them still. See, all these little things that... I'm realizing I was maybe more of a scared kid than I thought I was. I was scared of, the door things, those coiled up door things that make that, like, boing noise. There's my sound effect for you. Those freaked me out. We don't have those in our house anymore, I don't think, but those always freaked the heck out of me. And, the red blinking lights on top of, antenna towers. We had one of those in the distance when we were little. Oh, that would be a cute embroidery. And, that freaked me out. Like, if I had to go to the bathroom late at night, and then I looked out the window, and there was that red, blinky, like, alien light. Ugh, that scared me, too. So those are the things that scared me when I was little, and would probably still give me the heebie-jeebies a little bit. No. Or some still blatantly straight-out scare me now, as well. Like the insects and the raccoons, apparently. They would come in the house and go through everything. Eee, my gosh! That's crazy. Funny guys. Little raccoon guys. See, in my head, they're cute. And as a pet, they seem like they'd be cute. Oh, the wind turbines could be out. Oh, funny. We have a ton of those by my parents' house now. We have some smoke sets with lights at the top. Yeah, see? I don't like that. That's like the aliens coming for you. How about your own stuff? All right, one more stitch here on this little circle and back up to this heart. They don't like to be caged. Oh, that's interesting. I would think not. Nothing red in the dark is good. Hello, that is totally it, for sure. I'm with ya. All right, I'm just gonna continue where I left off. I'm gonna go around this way. I don't know, there's a few times walking in our neighborhood with those raccoons and their eyeballs. All shiny and staring back at me. That's scary. Yeah, I don't watch scary movies either. I don't like them. My husband likes them for some reason, but he can go out with his friends that like them. They can all do it. Oh, you like scary movies? I don't know. I have to be in the right setting. Oh, really? Oh, that's so funny. You know, I'm okay with, like, way out there scary movies, but I don't like when there's any chance that that stuff could happen for real. You know, like, serial murders and all that sort of stuff. Every bad horror movie in his Netflix queue for funny. Like, I like mysteries and that sort of thing, but I don't like, you know... Don't look at the wind in the mirror, because, you know, don't close the mirror, because something's going to be there when you close it, and, you know, or all those sort of things. I'm not a huge fan of those. I'd rather not, I mean, like, I'm sure some are fun and funny and just goofy and weird, and I've seen a bunch of them, too, but, like, I don't know, I'd rather not be thinking about that stuff when I'm trying to go to sleep. So I'd rather just choose not to. That's where I'm at now. Man, I am a really scared person. Sheesh. I don't know. Maybe that's why I'm a homebody. I just stay at home all day. I don't go out and do anything. Yep. Oh, no, it doesn't have a red eye. But he's not in the dark. Yep, the birdie has a red eye, but he's in the nice morning sunshine. That's where he is. Unlabeled movie, and it turned out to be Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Oh, funny. I think I might have seen that one. I don't remember. You stopped it. There you go. Alright. I'm gonna do these itsy bitsy little stitches here again. Oh, that's gross. 32. I'm still afraid. Oh, you know what? I am too. That Chucky doll. See, some of those ones that I saw, like, in junior high and stuff, those kind of freak me out. Like, Chucky and... I don't know. Someone asked a penguin fish name. I'm not sure I got that. Yeah, that was kind of the thing when you go to sleepovers, right? With scary movies. Oh, a significance to the penguin and fish name. Oh, it's, I actually have, if you go, I think I have it on my YouTube. It's actually from, the penguin and fish name comes from, it comes from, it's an animation that I did in college. Oh, you saw the video. Oh, funny. Oh, no, it's not a book. It's an animation that I did in college out of cut paper pieces that I animated in, an editing tool in Adobe After Effects. I never finished it. It's halfway done. But I think in the video I have the storyboards for the rest of it in there, too. I can't remember. I do have it all completely storyboarded. But anyway, it was an animation that I did in college, and it was about... a penguin and a fish who meet and fall in love, and they do fun things together and hang out. And, oh, it does look kind of quilty. Oh, that's funny. I never thought about that. And then the fish has to migrate away because it migrates. And then they're sad because they can't be by each other. And then they stay in touch through email. And it's loosely based on my husband and I suppose, my now husband. Because we went to school together, and then he graduated and didn't go to school there anymore. So anyway, that's the penguin and the fish animation. And so it seemed fitting for our company. Anyway, I had to fast forward it so I could get the movie out of my mind. Yeah, I remember, like, seeing arachnophobia and stuff, but I don't know, for some reason I don't feel like I wouldn't enjoy watching that again, but I don't think that would do anything for me now. Oh, the Texas Chainsaw one. Oh, you saw it! Oh, thanks! I'm glad you thought it was cute. Yeah, oh, and that's kind of, you know, those characters are where the logo, my logo and stuff comes from, too. But yeah, that was, man. Let's see. Oh, that's almost 20. That was 18 years ago, I think. No, not 18 years ago. Yeah, maybe close to 18 years ago. I think it would scare you, not gonna lie. I wouldn't enjoy it. I feel like I might have caught some of it on TV or something sometime, and I was just kind of like, okay, fine. Oh, thanks, Martha. Oh, I think I have it on all my email signatures, too, that little animation. I think we're going to go to the hotel from The Shining this summer. Oh, my God. I think my parents did that. But you know what? I think they went, and I think my mom hadn't seen it yet, and she said that she was glad that, I think she was glad that she didn't go beforehand. And yeah, I would have been glad to not go beforehand. But yeah, they stayed there. Oh, I hope you have a good time. That's just so kind of creepy. There's an app. Have you guys heard this? I think they started it in... I think it opened in Minneapolis here. I'm not even sure if it opened yet. But they turned... By they, I mean someone. I don't know who. But someone turned The Shining into an opera. And I think they based it on, it must be a, you know, yeah, it was, you know, it was based more on the book than the movie, I think. But yeah, and but like a full-on opera, like with, you know, opera singers. And, you know, it's not like a musical or anything like that. It's a full-on opera. And I think they, I think they're doing it in here at the Minnesota Opera. I don't know if it happened already. I heard it on the radio or something. But I thought that was pretty fascinating. I didn't see The Shining until I was in college. And we went to this theater. Like, I think they redid the theater now, but it was this grungy little theater. Andrew might know it. The Uptown, well, probably knows it. The Uptown Theater in by Lake Calhoun here. And, oh, man, it was, the seats are so close, and, you know, it was pretty bad. But now it's nice now. But that's the first time I saw The Shining, and it was a weird way to see it, because everyone there knew the movie and had seen it a bajillion times. I just, you know, I didn't really like scary movies, so I never sat down and watched it. And that was the first time I watched it, and I don't know, that's Kubrick, right? That's a Kubrick movie. I studied Kubrick in college, so, I mean, he's got a lot of creepy movies like that. Is that a Kubrick movie? I'm probably totally wrong, aren't I? I don't know. But anyway. Oh, just never saw the movie Too Scary. Oh, funny. The books probably would freak me out. Anyway, that was the first time I saw that. I think that's the only time I saw it. Yeah, Kubrick. Yeah, I'm like, when I said it out loud, I'm like, that probably sound really dumb if I got that wrong. But anyway. But yeah, like, I love Kubrick movies. But, yeah, I mean, maybe that's why I saw it. That could be, because I might have been taking that class. All right, I have enough bread here for a little bit more, so I think I might just go till I'm done again. So we'll be a little over the time again tonight. I've been going over like every night just to use up thread. So we're gonna just start going through all these little books here. But we got this little birdie done, so that's exciting. Another like tiny, tiny, tiny little stitches here, just like this guy down here. I mean, it's small, you know. I mean, when we're done here, I'll show you, like, against against me, to just show you how small it is. Oh, Twilight Zone. You know what? I think we watched some of those. Those always creep me out a little bit. Those might be fun to watch. A few minutes here and there, I don't feel like much, but the extra project adds up nicely. It sure does. That's why I love embroidery too, like, you know, waiting in line and all that sort of stuff. You never know, like, even if I got 4 stitches done, you know, that would be 4 stitches further than I was before. So, I mean, it's true, every little tiny thing adds up to a finished piece, you know? I'm totally down with that concept. But yeah, we got a lot farther tonight because we, you know, we kept going last night with that. Yeah, pretty tame, just quirky. Yeah, it'd be fun to watch all those again now, kind of in a better mindset. I was pretty young, I think, when those were out. It's just not something that we watched in the house at home a lot, so I'm like partially familiar with it all. Don't hug me, I'm scared. Are all the sewn sets in film? Are all sewn sets? Wow. See, I like sci-fi stuff and all that, so, I mean, I like all that stuff, so... you know, I think it's just the really, I don't know, murdery movies, I suppose. Do I sell this pattern? This is a free pattern right now over at thesplendidsampler.com. So you can download it for free right now. Yeah, it's part of the Splendid Sampler Quilt Along. Scare fly now. Exactly. Yeah, I mean, if they're way out there. I mean, you know what? I say this when I watch, like, all the Walking Deads and stuff, but to me, that's a little different. That's more like an HBO show where it's about the people and stuff. But I don't know. Still, I don't know. Those, that first season of Walking Dead, just, you know, getting used to it all and the intensity that you know, was intense. But intense is different than super scary, I guess. I don't know. It's little things, too. You like ghosty stuff? Oh, that's interesting. For me, it's more moments. It's not like a whole concept or movie or anything like that. It's like little moments. Like, you know, I don't know if any of you saw Signs. You know, everyone just thought that movie was dumb or whatever. But there's a moment where the alien scary guy is up on the neighbor's roof and he's just a silhouette. And that totally, like, that moment just sits in my head as, like, really scary. Because, you know, like, at my parents' house, it's just kind of all open space, kind of. And, you know, you can kind of see the neighbors. And if I saw that on top of my neighbors, I would freak the hell out. And, you know, even at my neighbors here, too. You know what I mean? And it's just, like, moments. It's little moments like that I don't like. And that's all scary movies are. It's like, each one has like one tiny little movie or one tiny moment that sticks with me and I don't know, that I just don't like it. I'd rather just not know about it. Nope, I have not seen The Village. I watch scary movies less and less now, actually. But I do like drama things, like, you know, what's that HBO show that had Matthew McConaughey and Woody Harrelson, the guy from Cheers? That show, yeah, suspense I like. Like that was creepy and, you know, whatever. But that was True Crime, yeah. Oh, True Detective, that's what it is. True Detective. Yeah, the first season of True Detective, I just started the second one, and I don't know. I'm kind of can't get with it. But yeah, True Detective. You know, that was all drama and, you know, suspense and kind of, or just, who like, figuring it out. But to me, that's not, like, horror. That's not scary. But, like, okay, for example, one that I have not watched, I have no desire to watch at all just because the poster is enough to be like, no, I'm not doing that. It's, like, Human Centipede, for example. I don't know if you saw that, and that's just one that I will not see. Oh, Criminal Minds, you can't watch anymore. I'm told it was so funny. Good Police through an Amazon Prime. Oh, Bosch. Oh, I like the books. See, I think I would like, you know, it's funny. When I was little, do you guys remember, there was a couple of those kind of murder, mystery, but children's books, like for teenagers or tweens or something. Oh god, what, like, Goosebumps, that was one, right? But that wasn't the one that I read. There was another competing kind of series. Christopher Pike is the name that is in my head. Is that familiar? Is that right? I don't know. I can't remember. That name just came to my head, and I think it's probably totally wrong. But that one, those, I read those when I was little and stuff, and, like, kept reading them, and I really liked them, so I don't know, you'd think I'd like scary movies. Oh, when you did the yo-yos, it made me feel like people want to kill me. Yeah, I see that. No, it wasn't that. Nope, not the Hardy Boys. It was more like murders happening, and then figuring out who did it sort of thing. Like, it was, like, hardcore. Christopher Pike, for me, or to me, that's, like, sticking out in my brain. Oh, yeah, Nighttime in Parking Lots. Yep, totally. All right, I got another one of these little flowers that I just jumped into here. I wasn't even paying attention, and then all of a sudden I'm stitching a flower. Oh, Scooby-Doo. Oh, Seven. Yeah, I haven't seen that in a long time. Oh, R.L. Stein! Wait, is that it? Wait. I don't know if that's what I'm thinking of. That might have been a little older. No, not, it wasn't Goosebumps. I can't remember. I can't remember what they were. I'll have to look them up, though. Oh, so there is Christopher Pike. Okay, so yeah. Those are the ones that I read. Because Goosebumps was a different thing. But Christopher Pike ones were, like, the other guy who wrote about that stuff. So, okay, so that's who I was reading. Oh, no, I didn't read that. The Fear Street stuff. I think it was Christopher Pike. I'm pretty positive now. But yeah, I read a ton of those books, and those are all, like, murders and, you know, kid murders and all this stuff. Oh, was it vampires and stuff? I just remember. Like, I just remember them saying, like, someone getting in a car crash and, like, this is, like, bad, but, like, finding the head in the bush, and I'm, like, thinking, I'm a kid, and I'm reading this, and this is, like, not right. Spooksville and Cheerleaders. Oh, are those names of the books? Man, I wouldn't even know. I just remember that I'd go to the bookstore, our little bookstore in our town, and it would be, yeah, it'd be the Christopher Pike books, and it'd be the, like, Goosebumps books, and I was all into the Christopher Pike ones, and I'd just keep buying those, like, I'd buy tons of those and read them. Which is so weird, I don't know. Those are the movies I don't want to watch, are those books that I used to read, basically. Lights on forever. Yeah, I must be, I don't know, realizing my scaredy catness and wimpiness lately, I think. I've never read, you know what, I'm not sure I've read a Stephen King book just because I don't want to be scared. Which is horrible, because I should, because he's, like, a master. I'm reading a whole lot more now. I should pull one of those out. I just don't like going to bed after reading scary stuff. It's all about the sleep for me. I can't have things keeping me up. The Stand was your favorite, but it was so long. Maybe I'll check that out. Definitely scared. What's in the dark, not the dark. There you go. Yeah. Scared of shadows. How about that? I'm scared of the shadows in the dark. Moving shadows. Alright, I'm going to weave this in, and then I think we're going to call it for the evening. We got a little bit farther. It is scary. Isn't it the one with the clown? My brother used to read these. Oh, you know what? I think that was The Stand. Okay, I'll have to check that one out. I'm just going to have to do it at some point, right? So I'll for some reason, I feel like I might have even owned The Stand and never read it. I was reading it. I hate antique... Oh, man. There's antique refrigerators. I'm not going to like antique refrigerators after reading The Stand. Okay, well, I don't know if I want to read The Stand anymore. Good against evil. Yes, but... You can't see it's scary. Oh, yeah. All right. Here we are, guys. This is where we are tonight. Got this little guy done and started on here. So, I don't know. How many more sessions do you think? I don't know. We could probably get this in one. You know what? I still think it's going to be three sessions. And then we got to take the Fabrisalvi off yet. So, I don't know. I think three sessions will... this we did in two sessions. So yeah, I'm guessing three. All right, I'm going to flip you guys around and we will call it an evening. Oh, thanks guys. Hey there again. Yeah, I don't know. The Stand, I may have to look, I might have to just look it up and do it just to like, I know he's a genius and I know he's just super great, and I just need to jump in and do it. So, thanks for the recommendation. I will probably, I'll go to my library, and I can look up the books, and they'll bring the book to my library, which is awesome. So maybe I'll plop that in and see. Plan on 2 great weeks. Oh, is it long? All right. So here we are, guys. Yeah, we did. I would call this just about halfway done, I think. You know, maybe almost halfway done, but getting those birds through, was a good chunk, because the birds had a lot of detail in there. So yeah, I think we can, let's shoot for 3 more sessions and done. So, but not till we have a free moment again, because tomorrow is New Black Day. So, all right, guys, thanks again for coming in. I will check out the stand from the library, and I will let you know how it goes. So, all right, I'll see you again tomorrow at 9:30 p.m., and I will work on getting all my videos from this block up, hopefully tonight yet. So, except for this one will take overnight to upload, but all the other ones before this, I'll do my best to get up tonight. So, thanks again. I will see you tomorrow, 9:30. Adios.